The left must not be complicit through either silence or non-action. Kurdish protesters across Europe and in Turkey have ignited a beacon of hope. But the question that remains unanswered is, how are we to act? How can we ensure such action is not yet another sacrifice to the altar of the liberal peace?
So what I think is that the Kurdish freedom movement is a movement not just for all Kurds, but all the minorities within these territories, as diverse as they are. But it also provides an institutional setting that is local and therefore is particular and close to the local communities, the villages, etc., and the individuals. So what is actually going on on the ground there is a rethinking of the concept of democracy. In the place of the state, the movement is based around organisations at the council level that actually has face-to-face democratic procedures in place at the level of the village, at the level of the town. And it was a formal shift away in the Kurdistan Workers' Party, or the PKK, which had been set up in 1978, basically along with the traditional communist state party line. You know, it had the secretary general, etc. Around 2000, Ocalan started shifting towards this more libertarian socialist idea. And so his argument is being that we shouldn't leave history to the nation state and capitalism, but should rather think of modes of ordering beyond them amongst ourselves. So the PKK has since diversified itself. It's not really the head organisation at all. Now it comprises several different parties. There's a co-party for women, a number of sister parties in all of the other states. They have their separate armed forces. There's a cluster of a number of associations and institutions, all to create at the ground level. Perhaps the most important is what's called the KCK, or the Association of Communities in Kurdistan. And this is basically the key network of between villages, city, regions, and all their councils, and they assemble in what's called the Kurdistan People's Congress. So this move away from the state has had obviously very important repercussions, because no longer claim for statehood or hierarchy, has potentially allowed the Kurdish movement to no longer be labelled as a terrorist organisation, but one that's seeking the liberation of its own people. So there are basically three levels of this model. The first is the Democratic Republic, which will cover all Kurdistan, and the second is the Democratic Confederalism, which cuts across the local communities and relates them to the regional organisations, and the third is the grassroots, or the bottom level, which is the direct autonomy of the groups and individuals themselves.
Attacking Kobane before they attacked Mosul, and then when they moved into Mosul, that's when the other powers started realizing that the game that they planned is not going accordingly, because they thought if we use ISIS to remove all the Kurds from the Middle East and use those Islamic jihadists to benefit from the situation in the Middle East, then we'll be in power again in Iraq and Syria. But their plan didn't go accordingly, because they thought Kurds are going to give up and they're not going to be able to fight against ISIS. But those powers who were killing people because they were demonstrating against the attacks in Shangar, in Kobane, were being called democratic countries. The understanding of democracy has lost its real meaning in the Middle East. When the United States first went into this game, they thought, okay, these people, they don't have the military equipment and they can't resist. But once they saw after 35 days that these people are still resisting, even though they don't have the weapons that ISIS are using against them, then they had to change their tactics, because people started asking the United States, why are you helping people in Iraq but not Kobane? What's the difference between Kobane and Iraq? What's the difference between those two areas? So-called terrorist groups were helping and saving thousands of people's lives, risking their lives and saving those people, but why is United States not doing anything about it? What was the difference? All we ask from people that believe in humanity that believe in democracy to support Kurdish struggle, help Kurds in Kobane and in Shingal. We need to raise awareness and we need to wipe ISIS and ISIL out of Kobane. When we do this, then there will be a true example of peace in the Middle East. So many of ISIS groups are living in Turkey. About 80% of ISIS militants who came from all around the world have used Turkish borders to enter Syria and Iraq. And this is the country who's talking about democracy, who's talking about equality, but calling Kurdish people terrorists at the same time. I want to make one thing very clear. If Kurdish people were the terrorists for over how many years, they would not save thousands of people's lives. If PKK was a terrorist, they would not risk their lives and go into Shingal to save thousands of people's lives. PKK has showed everyone what true freedom struggle is all about, by putting their life at risk, by saving innocent people, regardless of their background and their identity. And they have shown people that no matter how big, how strong their guns are, our will of freedom, our hope for freedom will always win. Thank you.
To a point, the kind of nationalistic strict border policy which we fight against as this kind of anti-nationalism, anti-imperialist activism that we see, particularly in Australia with Australia tightening up their border policy, it really echoes this global movement. And of course the Kurdish movement is one of promoting this Kurdish identity and demanding autonomy, but it's something which has arisen from this defensive perspective to being oppressed, making it a movement particularly important to us here as activists, because it's not this oppressive nationalism. It's this kind of equality promoting movement. And so most importantly for the Middle East, in general, it's this movement has the potential to break down the territorial but also social borders, which Western, namely American, as we've seen, intervention has helped to foster and manipulate for its own imperialist agenda. When we analyse it more closely, it becomes clear that it generates this vicious cycle when there is more badly done intervention, with their own agenda, where the first wave of devastation from the West and its continuing legacy provide the desperation and disparity which is needed to push possible threats to new extremes. So the answer to this problem is really in the Kurdish struggle. It's the PKK is a Kurdish fighting force against ISIS, proves that a solidarity that crosses borders for them and for the Middle East generally, it means an autonomous fighting force for the people who are being threatened against their attacker. So it's a globally reaching challenge to the US's idea that the only power strong enough to protect anyone is them, and that it can be used to its supposed power for its own agenda.